Don't you hate when you're trying to make a video and you're hanging with friends and you get stage fright? It's weird because I've just drank half a liter of pulque, and we're here at the pulqueria at the bottom of the hill of the Guachimontones. So, good times. Welcome to Paradise Paradox. My name's Aaron Battle. I'm here with friends from Australia. I dragged my wife along because she likes the adventures. And in today's episode, we are going to talk about standards. Now, it's a topic Kurt brought up. It's a little abstract, but this is what he's looking for, or ideas that he's interested in when looking for a future life partner. We touch on various topics, but we end up talking about ayahuasca and how it's changed our lives. In my case, I have been hit with a stick of shallow hell because what's happened, and it sounds silly. I'll just explain to these guys what it was about. But essentially, my whole world just became more beautiful. I think anyone that does ayahuasca connects with Mother Earth, and they start feeling more love, a higher frequency of energy. So pretty much, it could be because I'm married, but I appreciate all feminine energy, and all women have become more beautiful. It's in English, so my wife won't get jealous. it's cool. Okay, so enjoy the ep. Thank you to everyone that's sending through their donations and support. Check out the www.theparadiseparadox.com because we're selling shirts. I haven't got one on right now, but a couple of designs that are up are pretty cool. We promote sound money, Bitcoin, gold, and silver. And we also promote disclosure. So I want disclosure. There's an alien coming down on top of the pyramid of Chichen Itza in a tie-dye design. So if you're into that, pink, blues, might be yellow, but it's a few different colors. I've got a couple in order, so hopefully I can show you the shirts soon.
Enjoy the show.
Show you something. This,
you notice, okay.
Notice what shirt I'm wearing.
Yes.
You want to describe it for the listeners?
It looks good.
That's a graphic description.
it looks tasty. This is the first shirt that was designed by the Paradise Paradox team. It was to support sound money. It's got Bitcoin about the size of a palm in the middle of your chest there. To its side, it's got two other friends, gold and silver. it happens to the best of models.
Okay.
It's, on the runway. Yeah, it's our real money Paradise Paradox shirt.
Yeah, cool.
I'm happy to see it finally in the real.
So yeah, go ahead, order it from Spreadshirt, but you can't trust Mexican Post. So if you happen to be in Mexico, definitely pay the extra for the express post. Otherwise, you could be waiting 4 months for the shirt.
Was that 4 months or 4 months? So,
what's the difference? What?
Yeah, it's true. Okay, it's a while either way.
What? I don't get it. Okay.
No, but you were waiting over 4 months for it. It wasn't just a few months. It was like almost half a year.
Yeah, it was a while. I don't know. It's kind of a little bit awkward because at the time I was dating this girl, Carla, and so I ordered a one as well. And now I messaged her yesterday saying, hey, so I've got a present for you because since we're not seeing each other anymore. Yeah. And she's like, a present? Why? I'm like, don't worry, it's nothing weird. It's, yeah.
Yep.
Yeah. So
she still wants it?
Well, I didn't tell her what it was. I thought it would be cool to make it a surprise. And
okay, nice.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, so I'll give it to her tomorrow. Cool. So I've got a lot of weird, half weird stories to tell here. But first, I just had something going through my mind. So, someone just posted shared this pic on Facebook from Pictoline. You know the Facebook page Pictoline?
No.
No. Okay. Well, they shared these interesting things.
Hola, ¿qué tal? We have visitors.
Yeah. They share these interesting...
It's a family house.
Sure. They share things a lot of the time talking about economics and interesting little facts, but they put them in the form of infographics so they're easy to digest, but it's all in Spanish. This graphic that came up was talking about income disparity. And it was saying how a lot of rich people would say things like, well, if those poor people want to do something for themselves, they just need to pull themselves up by their bootstraps, or this kind of idea.
Yeah, yeah.
And, I kind of think there is some truth to that, though it's a bit funny for me because this is like the stereotype of a libertarian where he or a conservative as well, I guess, where he says, well, those fucking poor just need to work harder, that's their problem, like a Fox News conservative type thing.
But I
wonder about this. So this is what it says. So it says, For a rich child, as they get on in life, they earn 40% more remuneration during the adult age for every year of additional education. So I assume it means every year beyond high school. And the thing is, I do think there's some truth to this because for example. There's these lads that hang around the building, and so I see them, and they have a lot of them have jobs, I guess, and they do things like I see a couple of them washing cars and stuff like that in the street. But yeah. Whenever I go down there at night, they're standing outside the liquor store and they're asking me for 5 pesos so they can buy a drink. And occasionally I give it to them. Most of the time I don't. But here's the thing. So I have to wonder, like, they have this thought process enough that they can say, okay, so if I ask this güero for 5 pesos and I get 5 pesos, then 5 pesos I can use to buy a beer. Now, that's a, you know, quite a simple thought process. But they never ask me things like, hey, can you teach me some English? Because I want to get ahead. Like I want to move forward in my professional development. They never ask me that. They do ask me for swear words in English, and now every time I walk past them, they say, "Hey, more cushion for the pushy."
Oh, cool! You were creative.
Yeah, because I don't know how that came out there, but
it's valuable.
Yeah, and it's it's kind of funny because one of them actually does have a girlfriend who's a bit on the larger side, and I'm like, maybe you shouldn't say that around your girlfriend. And then, you know, when my friends that speak English come over, like lady friends. And they're walking around the building with me, and there's this these four cholos, or not cholos, but chavos, standing around the building, yelling more cushion for the pushing.
No, I know the guys. I was the guy that turns up in the bocho every week or second week when I was there in Guadalajara, and they'd be like, 25 pesos, I wash your car. But, I'd give them 5 pesos and say,
a pretty good deal.
Just keep an eye on it. Yeah, it's not bad, but I just didn't want him touching my car.
Okay. Yeah. Fair enough.
It's cool. It's cool that you bring that up because I think you're right. Well, firstly, it's so easy to say that, you know, people, if they're poor, just go get a job, go make something, sell something, like, the, you know, do something.
Yeah.
But I kind of understand the attitude of just hanging out and wanting to get their 5 pesos for a beer. Uh-huh. Or, see?
Yeah, see.
Estamos grabando, güey.
Yeah, I don't know if I can talk to my nephew like that. ¿Me permites media hora? Y nos vemos abajo. ¿Cómo ves?
Sí, ¿cómo hiciste eso?
Es un video. Toma, nos vemos.
All right, it's a little Spanish lesson for you.
¿Puedes cerrar la puerta saliendo? Porfa. Okay, this is going to be a funny episode. A new studio with no lock on the door.
Yeah.
So what I was saying is, I think I can understand the attitude of we're just wanting to hang out and just roll through the days with no real aspiration.
Yeah.
To grow yourself into something.
But there's nothing wrong with that. But it is a choice. People have their priorities. So if one of these guys said to me, "Hey man, can you give me some English lessons, like just 15 minutes a day or something like that?" I'd be like, "Yeah, sure. You know, what do you want to know?" I would give them my time. I would help them for free, without asking anything. But they never do. They never do. Or even if they made friends with me and asked me sometime, or I would probably even offer if they made friends with me, but they don't. So it's like, at some level you have to say it's about priorities. So it's not like, somebody was born, well, I mean, to some extent it is, somebody was born into a rich home, and so they have these priorities, which are like about trying to improve their financial position or something like that. And people who were born into poor places don't have those priorities, and they don't work towards those things, and that continues throughout their life a lot of the time.
Where do you think these priorities come from? Because that I mean, I feel like that's exactly it. Either you want to or you don't. I mean, I've been staying with some cousins, and they're learning English in high school. And they ask me to check the homework, but they never ask me to expand, you know, to help them learn more. It's just like, yeah, just check it so I get a good grade, and who cares? Like that effort or that, you know, that extra isn't there.
I can understand that too, because it's school and they drill it into you, and it's something boring.
Mm-hmm.
Whatever you learn in a school, it tends to be boring for you. Like, even if they teach you Shakespeare, you know, some of the greatest plays ever written in English, you'll find that absolutely, you know, intolerable if you learned it in high school.
That's a sad dynamic of schooling.
Yeah.
Because I mean, personally, I hated school.
Yeah.
And I just did it because, you know, make mum and dad proud. And I feel like I'm studying everything now. It's like all of a sudden your interest for different things just pop up, you know, mid-20s, early 30s, and you're like, you know, I want to learn this all of a sudden. Mm. And it's like, even though you might have touched on it back in high school, the interest wasn't there at that point.
Yeah, yeah. So... yeah, well, I'd be curious if people have some comments and put them in the comment sections and tell us what they think. Like, is it a question of priorities? Is it more about what family you're born into, or is it something else that we haven't considered? Because it is a complex question, no doubt. ¶¶ So I've got this whole bunch of stories to talk about here. So firstly, going to go back in time to one night when I was about 23, I remember I was in 22, 23. I was living in Maitland in my hometown. Went out to Newcastle, and my buddy Kieran had a band, a hip hop band, Dopek, and Kieran's the drummer, and he said to me, "Well, you can get up with us when we drop a beat. You can come in and freestyle with us." And I was like, "Okay, cool. That sounds great." And so I got up towards the end of the set and just jumped up and had a good time. I had some rhymes I was kicking around my mind beforehand. It wasn't anything deep or meaningful, but it was just some fun rhymes. But they were on point, like focused straight in, you know.
yeah, you were jacked into the moment.
Yep, exactly.
But these rhymes were not, I mean, they're all, off the cuff, though, like just freestyle.
Yeah, off the top, yeah.
Nice. How did you pull that off?
I mean, half off the top, because I had something like prepared in my mind,
yep.
But I hadn't written anything down. So, like half and half kind of thing.
Cool, yeah.
Yep. Anyway, so afterwards, one of Kieran's friends, or it was his ex-girlfriend, or I don't know what the deal was. Anyway, she started getting like these puppy dog eyes, and she was like, "Wow, Kurt, I didn't know you could do that." And I was like, "Yeah, cool." I guess it didn't exactly know how to respond, but anyway, I didn't get her phone number or anything, because it was a big complex situation, whatever. But the thing was, later that night, I went to, what's that other bar? I'm trying to remember. The Cambridge. I think it was at the Cambridge. Just talking to some guys, whatever, this other very, very attractive young lady is like, again, making these puppy dog eyes at me out of nowhere and starting conversation and being very flirtatious. And I'm like, this is kind of weird. I mean, not that I'm complaining, but this is not what normally happens to me, at least not then. It was an unusual experience. And I thought, what the fuck is going on here? Like, like, how can I have? It's because it seemed like what had happened was I had this kind of residue, like in the first at the last, I had bust this rhyme, and so the crowd was impressed, and so I had this energy behind me, or people who had seen it were interested by that, and that's why the first young lady was interested in me. But when I get to the Cambridge, nobody's seen that. So why is this young lady flirting with me? I asked you. I guess a year or so after that, I asked a mentor of mine about it, and he said what it's about is your state. So you got up there and you bust this sick rhyme. You were in the moment and you didn't care what anybody thought of you. You were just expressing yourself as to the fullest. And so because of that, you got into this flow state, and that's what's attractive. So later in the night, even though nobody had seen it, you still had that flow state. And so you're still attractive to women. And yeah, that makes perfect sense. But at the time I was like, holy shit, that's how it, is that really how it works? Like, you just feel good and other people feel good around you. And that's so simple, but it makes so much sense. Lately, I've been... I've been thinking about some things. So I want to find a woman for a long-term relationship, because, well, for one thing, when we took ayahuasca back in November, I remember ayahuasca said to me, and someone else had said this to me before, that you got to be careful with your sexual energy. Like, sexual energy isn't something to be fucked with, so to speak. Mm-hmm. It's something delicate, which is what someone said to us. It's also, obviously there's an energy interaction when you're intimate with somebody, whatever level you take that on. And ayahuasca had said to me, look, do whatever you want, but if you keep having casual sex with women, you're probably going to have problems. That was kind of the message.
I think most people get that. But was there any particular type of problem here? Because I'm thinking energy-wise, you know, from the articles and bits and pieces I come across, I always held back a little bit when it came to having sexual relations with, you know, not with random people, but, you know, with, like, you know, having partners too close together in time, because they say that problems or emotional baggage that people have can be passed on to people. I don't know if there's truth to that, but I feel like, I mean, just from examples of friends that, you know, it kind of shows you do have to be careful.
Yes. Yes.
Like, out of nowhere, someone's just like, you know, not quite himself anymore. What happened? There's always a name. She did it.
okay. You mean like the succubus phenomenon, I guess, like where the guy's manipulated by the girlfriend and she stops him hanging out with his guy friends or something like that.
Well, I think that's kind of the most simplest form.
Yeah.
But I mean, I've seen friends, they start seeing a new girl and, you know, she's not quite right for them. And then all of a sudden, your mate's just off for, you know, the next 3 months. I mean, just, you know, just not scoring tens anymore.
Okay, so you mean it puts his game off?
Or... Yeah, I mean, well, whole life. He's just like, decisions aren't quite right. He just seems, you know.
Okay, when you said scoring tens there, you didn't mean...
Let's see, without getting myself in trouble.
All right. I mean, it interferes with his work life, it interferes everything. With his personal life, with his friends and family, whatever.
Yep.
Yep. Okay. Yeah. I don't know. I don't think I have any personal examples of that, but I guess, and, you know, especially if a guy gets obsessed, you know, if he, yeah, there are a lot of things that can happen. It kind of occurred to me that a few weeks ago, I suppose. The thing is, I do believe that. Let's see. I tentatively believe that life begins at conception, so I don't necessarily know that life begins at conception, but I do think. At some stage in a pregnancy, you can say that life begins. Now, where does that point lie? I don't know. And it would be better to err on the side of caution, because I don't want to be, in terms of abortion, I would never want to be involved in ending a life, if I could avoid it. Yeah. Now, that wouldn't necessarily mean that I think abortion should be illegal, because that's just getting the government involved and that just causes more problems.
Yes.
But I do think people should hopefully exercise personal responsibility, and if a woman were to become pregnant because of me, I would attempt to persuade her. not through coercion, not coercing her, but I would attempt to persuade her to keep the baby in some form. Now, so I thought, well, that's an idea that I've held for a long time. But what are the real consequences of that? Because if I don't think women should have abortions, and I don't think I'm ready to have a child, financially and you know, in other situations, we could probably talk about that another time.
Yeah.
But if I don't think I'm ready, then what's going to happen? I'm really being irresponsible. If I let the possibility in to my life of creating life that that I'm not ready to sustain, then I have a problem. So the logical consequence of that is that I intend to be celibate. Now, it sounds a bit weird to me, because I definitely haven't been celibate for many years.
Well, I think it's only weird because being a dude, you understand, that's just crazy talk.
yeah.
But I understand, like, logically, you know, you don't want to handle any of the... I mean, you just don't want the results, possible results, for, you know, for that kind of action.
Yes.
Therefore, yes. Just remove the action.
Yeah, remove the risk. Yeah. So, I mean, you know, they say condoms are about 2% ineffective. So which means that if there are 100 couples having sex for 1 year, two of them will become pregnant if the condoms are used entirely correctly according to the instructions, which most people don't. Don't follow them strictly. No, excuse me.
They aren't exactly complicated. So, and it's usually the guy that's applying, and he never reads instructions.
Well, this the thing is, like, if there's an air bubble in the condom, if I think you're supposed to remove it, what I heard once was if you exit and then you penetrate again, you're supposed to put on a new condom. I'm not sure if that's right, but see, I've never done that, or very rarely.
That's complicated. A lot can happen in between.
Yes, that's right. Yeah, so the thing is, you know, a 2% chance over a year. Well, it's, you know, it's a low chance, but it's still a chance.
Yeah.
I mean, do I really want to take that? Because, I mean... that's a lot better chance than, for example, winning the lottery. I don't mind winning the lottery, but if I have a baby on my hands and I'm in that position, well, that's a complicated matter for me.
So, yeah, I feel like it's only complicated now that it doesn't exist, because all of a sudden it's like a world flip. But once it's flipped and you're on the other side, it's like you just make the most of it.
Right. But, yeah. I mean, making the most of it is important, and we definitely should make the most of it. But on the other hand, we shouldn't put ourselves into a position where we're forced to make the most of a bad situation.
No, but 2% is pretty low.
Not low enough.
No, it's not.
You're. I can't see you. It's very getting very dark.
Okay.
Yep. All good.
Cool. Okay.
So. Yeah, so I started thinking about it, like, what would I really want in a woman? And these are some rough guidelines that I came up with, and I think that I'm going to need to think more deeply about them, because I don't think this really captures what I am looking for. But these are three simple things which I've come up with so far.
Yep.
So the first is that she would be bilingual. And... it doesn't necessarily need to be English and Spanish or whatever. But the point is, if someone is bilingual, I think they have a much broader perspective on the world. And also I think it shows open-mindedness. And it shows courage too, because I don't think people don't really talk about this that much, but to say the first words in another language and expose yourself to the potential of being a fool, it does take guts. And a lot of the time people don't have that. And that's one of the things that I admire about you, because when you came to Mexico, you basically didn't speak any Spanish. You didn't have any, training or anything. And you just worked your way up from zero.
I just faked it till I spoke it.
Yeah. Yeah.
It was full on. Because, I mean, I'm going to digress a little bit here.
Sure.
What happened was, I actually, in Australia, this was a problem. Not because I couldn't speak Spanish, but I just didn't feel Mexican enough. You know, I look fair Mexican, but it was like everyone's like, hey, that's Aaron, he's the Mexican. You know, it was kind of like that was a common thing in my life. And I felt like a fraud. It's like, well, I don't speak Spanish. You know, I couldn't tell you the difference between a taco and an enchilada. I don't know any more than five states of Mexico. Yet I'm Mexican. So me coming to Mexico was a bit of that. Like, you know, now it's time to figure this out. And yep. and now that I've been here for these couple of years, I can say, yeah, I'm pretty Mexican.
Mm.
And Spanish still a challenge because my Spanish isn't perfect. At some point, I will go to school and learn Spanish properly rather than just spitting words and hoping it makes sense.
Jamming, tossing the word salad, yeah.
Yeah, but I think if I was to, this is crazy. If I was ever to start a rhyme rap career, I think I'd do better in Spanish than English because I learnt it basically on sounds. So that could be a future project.
You learned English on sounds too.
But for some reason, my brain doesn't do English very well. This is something I've noticed. And, you know, maybe I don't know Spanish well enough to figure out that I'm just not good with language in general. But yeah, English, although is my native tongue, I find it more difficult than Spanish. Like, I think Spanish is a little bit more intuitive.
Okay. What? How about Nahuatl?
That's something I need to learn. when I move to Oaxaca and learn how to whistle speak.
Do they do that?
I found a documentary only a few nights ago about the Oaxacan whistle speaking. And it's because the mountains, they whistle to each other from field to field. I'm not sure how I came across it, but it's like a dying language. And I'm thinking, well, if African tribes can click, why can't Mexicans whistle?
Well, Africans whistle as well.
Really?
Yeah. I remember reading this book about this tonal language in Africa, and it's so tonal, it's so focused around tones that they had these like drums and they would just bang the drums and people could understand. So you know, you bang the drums loud enough, you can hear it from a mile away.
Like Morse code. They just knew it.
They found out a way to, you know, send a telegram. Yeah.
Yeah, I think that's kind of how the whistle works as well, because, you know, from an untuned ear, it just sounds like, you know,
whales. Like,
yeah. It sounds like it's a hot chick walking past and some construction workers are on the other side of the road. But they're talking to each other. It's pretty fascinating.
Yeah. Yeah. Pretty cool. So first one, bilingual. And at least, you know, for that one, I kind of, I try to set the bar low, because if somebody can, even if they don't speak English or they don't speak French, but they can say, oh, well, you know, I know a little bit, and then they spit out some phrase, then I'll say, hey, you know, that's enough, because I know that, you're willing to put yourself out there and say something which might make you look foolish.
Yeah.
But all the better if they are actually bilingual. You know, they say that people can actually think more logically in their second language than their first, which is an interesting idea.
I think that's what I experienced, actually. Just in the, you know, in the last Spanish interview I did, I thought I seemed to articulate what I'm trying to say a lot better with less words, which is weird.
Yeah. Well, yeah, a lot of the times, Spanish does seem like it's a more succinct language. You can say stuff with less words. But yeah, sometimes it seems like the opposite as well. Yeah, so that's the first one. The second one is being open to psychedelic experiences.
Of course.
And, you know, I don't mind if someone's never had a psychedelic experience, or if they for some reason, maybe some mental condition, they decide not to do it.
Yeah, yeah.
Psychedelic experiences are so fascinating, and you know, long before I had a psychedelic experience, I was reading trip reports, and it made me think about, you know, what is this thing that we have in our heads, and how does it work, and what does this tell us about ourselves, and that sort of thing. So I think that's a very important thing. But when somebody says to me, I would never do LSD, or I would never do ayahuasca, or that sort of thing, it really turns me off, because it's like, I read this Facebook post the other day saying, when you say, I would never take psychedelic drugs, it sounds to me like you're saying, I would never take a trip to France. And I'm like, okay, you know, I understand France maybe isn't your first priority. I can understand that. That's, you know, that's completely normal. And I can understand you're concerned about the risks of going to Paris and being pickpocketed, because that definitely happens. But why never? Never? Like, never? You would never go to France? You never want to see the Eiffel Tower? Why? Well, how could that be a thing?
Yeah. well, that's their point of view now. In a few years' time, that could completely change. But even just talking about psychedelic drugs, that name in any of them, just saying, you know, I'm interested in psychedelic drugs or psychedelic experiences, it's shocking how many people might say to you, what are you, a drug addict? What are you, a junkie?
Right.
What, you want to throw your life away? I've heard this stuff, so
yeah. So this is kind of a little gatekeeper for me. Or it's like I was reading this article the other day that talked about how certain companies don't care so much whether you've got a college degree or not, but they will actually put some weight on whether you use Internet Explorer or Safari, because if you use Internet Explorer, that says you're not the kind of person who takes initiative. You're not the kind of person who adjusts their environment to be more interesting or more beneficial.
Yeah.
But if you use Chrome, Opera, Firefox, that does say that you're willing to change things around you to be better. So this is a similar thing, I think, for people. Not that. If someone is open to a psychedelic experience, it says something about them.
Yeah, that's pretty interesting, because I could tell you I was not open to these kind of experiences, you know, for the square part of my life. It just wasn't something I needed, I guess. And then later you kind of get to a point where you're like, well, now that I'm in Europe, Paris isn't so far away.
All right. So
if you follow what I mean.
You took some gateway drugs.
Oh, yeah. You know, the hardest
gateway. Start with the hardest and work down. Okay.
Yeah, that was a beer. I started with a beer.
Yeah. But if people are willing, if people are open to psychedelic experiences, then that says they're not willing to shut down based on some nonsense that they've heard in high school, which is a big thing for me. Because if you're willing to take, you know, some shit that some old fart told you 16 years ago as if it's gospel, that doesn't interest me. Come sit at the adults table.
I like that.
But yeah, I mean, that's a little too judgmental, because everybody has their own path and everything, but for me, that's how it seems.
I'm just checking that my just clearing my garbage bin.
Okay.
Because it just told me I got no memory left.
Okay.
Anyway, that's interesting that you said 16 years ago, some old fart's telling you something out of some book that, you know, is irrelevant.
Yeah.
I feel like we spent the first 15, 16 years in a box, and then we got out of the box, and it's taken us equal amount of time to realize what the box was. And now, now I'm starting my life fresh.
Yeah, it's like where a kind of like an Oscar fish that grows to the size of its tank, and then it gets released into the wild, and it's like, holy shit, I can grow bigger than this.
Yeah, or the tank wasn't even part of me. I thought that was my arm.
Yes, yes.
Like, what's that tank all about? I didn't need that.
Yeah, yeah. So the third thing is, and this should be something so simple. I thought it would be something so simple, but the third thing is, she has to have learned this lesson. If you practice something, you get better at it. And that, to me, seems like one of the most basic lessons that a person can learn about their life. I notice it. All of us, I guess, have this limiting belief to some extent in different areas. Because, for example, if I go back to when I was 15 and I heard about I was starting to write some rhymes, but I heard about this idea of freestyling, of improvising raps, and I thought, oh, I could never do that. But you know what? I could. It took practice. That's all it took. You practice something and you get better at it. It strikes me, Michoka, when people say to me, oh, you know, I tried that, but I wasn't good at it. And I say, come on, you know, come on, you tried it and you weren't good at it. I understand if you try it and you didn't like it, you didn't want to pursue it. That's fine. But if you tried it and you weren't good at it, the reason was, you just fucking started it. That's the reason. Of course you're not going to be good at it.
Y eso te choca.
Yes, yeah, that hits me right in the face.
Yeah, it's okay, I can't think of anything that really hits me that hard. But so your point number three is you need to find a girl that is good at something through hard work?
Yeah, I mean, I guess that's an indication. But the real thing is that they've learned this lesson. I mean, that being good at something is a symptom of learning this lesson, or it's something that runs in parallel.
Yeah,
because you learn that lesson through experience. You learn that through practicing something. You practice something that you're not good at. Turns out you're good at it.
Yeah,
holy shit.
Well, I mean, that ties in with the language stuff as well.
Yep.
Because, right, I mean, looking at, for example, my Spanish now compared to what it was even 6 months ago, I would say even 6 months, even now, I'm still saying the same thing. It's going to be great when I can speak Spanish well. And to a lot of people, I probably already do. but it's like this personal point of view, or driving a car, like a manual car. Like, that's not something you jump in a car and you can do straight away. Yeah. You need to learn how to drive, and it's like you want to be good, so you keep doing it. And then when you are, you don't think about it, but you're like, gee, I'm grateful I can drive well, or isn't it great to speak Spanish? Have you surprised yourself lately? Like, that was pretty good.
When I'm speaking Spanish, or
yeah,
let's see. I can't think of any particular occasion lately, but I guess it's kind of funny because it's always something where you have to remain a little humble with, I guess, because when you get good at something, you might reach this level of unconscious competence, and if you're that good at it, then you don't even have to think about it, and then you forget all the hard work that it took you to get to that stage.
Yeah.
So you have to look back on it and get some perspective, and you know that carries forth into your future endeavors. Yeah.
Yeah. That's it, isn't it? I mean, I think we've got a good couple examples of that. Even just what we're doing right now.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. We've gotten much better at this since we've started. So,
these are your top three. I mean, that's a pretty interesting list. I mean, it's not your standard. You know, she needs to be there.
Well, you know, okay. So in terms of physicality, I mean, I do have a wide range of what I consider a physically attractive in a woman. So that's not so much a big deal.
Yep.
But yeah, I mean that definitely plays into it, because if I see a woman who's not attractive and has these traits, well, I guess I'd have to consider it, but I don't know how I would get into that position in the first place, because normally I'm talking to a woman because I find her physically attractive first.
Yeah, that's something that I think is pretty standard with all interactions, just people. It's like club scene, a guy is going to talk to a girl if she's attractive. I mean, there's all levels in between that. I don't think I think we get hit with a bad stick about that, about guys are so superficial. And maybe we are, but I mean, that's just the way it is. I'm sorry. It's not my fault that I'd rather, you know, eat chocolate ice cream and not strawberry. It's like, they're just choices.
Yeah. But you know, I find that argument so bullshit when a woman says it, like, oh, I can't believe these men, they only talk to women who were attractive or something like that, or they only date women who would stereotypically attractive or whatever it is.
Yeah.
Because I remember saying this to a girl who made that argument to me. I said, well, hang on. You know, I mean, it's normally guys who approach women, right? And she's like, yeah. So who the fuck do you think you're going to approach? You're going to approach someone ugly? Like, if you had the responsibility to go out of your way and talk to people, would you be there talking to ugly dudes or to dudes which didn't appeal to you?
Exactly. Physically? Yeah.
Of course you wouldn't.
No way.
You know, it's going to be right down the list on your to-do list there. So,
well, there's another funny thing I've noticed is I'm starting to find, well, it's just in general, you know, the majority of women attractive. You know, not that I'm attracted to them, but just I'm just the level of attractiveness of the world is getting turned up.
Yeah.
And I'm not sure whether that's because, you know, now that I'm almost 2 years in, married, and, you know, I'm not looking, I'm not interested, but I just find that, or maybe because I'm getting older and my perspective's changing. But I just find, or maybe it's because I'm in Mexico, and there's just a higher percentage of attractive women. But I have to go to Reforma. I mean, not in Nessa York. I'm sorry, the suburbs don't cut it. No, there's too many native influences, I think. Not that's a bad thing. It's just the mix just doesn't turn out the best. I think in general, everyone's becoming more beautiful, and I don't know why.
Okay. Well, you mention this to me after we took ayahuasca, so I wonder if it's kind of let's see. You know, they say we don't see things as they are; we see things as we are.
Yes.
Or on the other hand, you know, to put it another way, you're starting to realize the beauty that exists in the world. I like this. Let's see. I was just the other day. I was going through this, writing some things about this classic movie, Don Juan de Marco. You know the movie?
I don't think so.
Okay, you have to see it. So it's starring Johnny Depp and Marlon Brando, and it's about the greatest lover the world has ever known. Okay. Anyway, so let's see. I have this quote from the movie on that note. Cool. So Don Juan says, "Now, there are those who do not share my perceptions. It's true. When I say that all my women are dazzling beauties, they object. The nose of this one is too large, the hips of another, they are too wide, perhaps. The breasts of a third, they are too small. But I see these women for how they truly are, glorious, radiant, spectacular, and perfect. Because I am not limited by my eyesight. Women react to me the way they do, Don Octavio, because they sense I search out the beauty within them until it overwhelms everything else, and then they cannot avoid their desire to release that beauty and envelop me in it. So to answer your question..." Okay, well, that bit's not entirely relevant, but...
Yeah, I think I got... that was in my cup of ayahuasca for sure, because I don't know if it was ayahuasca what we drank, because it didn't taste that bad, okay, and I didn't throw up, but it's messed my life up for sure, you know all the best ways.
They say it tastes worse every time you drink it.
Okay, so we're off for another round.
Step it up a notch.
It was only last week I put on, just, you know, as a joke, like, "Hey Aaron, it's your turn to pick the music," and I picked one of these Okaras. Oh, it's just a random ayahuasca Adam. Music on yep. YouTube. Yep. And out of nowhere, you know, I'm in the living room, so, you know, I'm taking little steps, and, you know, I'm thumping my chest like, you know, like Wall Street, and it's just funny, right? Because I'm dancing to an interesting song, but out of nowhere, I was just hit with this like emotion bomb, and it was just like, and I just started tearing up, and everyone's like, "What's wrong?" I got no idea. Just give me, just leave me in the moment. Yeah. And that's why I'm saying that stuff's like changed my life. Mm. Out of nowhere, I just connect to things. In ways that I don't understand. I just know that my emotional state just changes 180 for no reason. But it's cool.
the new normal.
Yeah, it is. But I mean, even just to see the world in a more beautiful state, because you do accept it, knowing that this is the only world. Actually, you know, I just thought of something that que me cae muy mal, something that is just the worst. When people
rub you the wrong way.
Yeah. Yep. And it's coming back to the, you know, the original topic about, you know, having about the 2% chance of condom failure and having kids. You know, well, I'm 2 years, almost 2 years in the relationship into being a married man now. So, you know, you feel the pressure from grandma and parental figures, like, "Hey, so Aaron, you take any time there? Where are the kids at?" Because, you know, they don't need to they just hang out with them a couple hours and then they give them back. They don't have to pay for it. They don't have to worry about all the other stuff. I mean, they've already done it. So they're like, hey, how about shed a little hell on someone else? But it's all good. You know, I'm keen to be a family man. So, you know, kids are in the mix at some point. I don't like talking to people. And, you know, the topic comes up of having kids and all that, especially, you know, in our age group, because, you know, not so much for men, but, you know, as soon as women start hitting their 30s, it's like they haven't had kids yet. It's like, you know, something you probably should be thinking about if you want to. And then you hear people say comments like, oh, I wouldn't want to bring a life into this world, or, you know, this world's too horrible, or, you know, this...
just bullshit.
It's Oof. Like, okay, well, what other world are you going to bring your kids into?
Yeah, well, my response to that is, no, well, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter how terrible the world is, because what you're bringing into this world is a gift. What you're bringing in is something special and something that's going to make the world a little better. So yeah. Why not?
Yeah, well, that's the next question. What are you doing for the world? Or is that someone else's responsibility?
Yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's true. It's like this cynical mentality that, probably expresses itself in the life in other ways. Yeah.
It sounds to me like their world is a lot worse than my world. My world's pretty good.
Yeah, my world's looking pretty good. I mean, you know, it might be a little shabby around the edges. You know, the rose that grew from the concrete has a few bruises on its petals, but it's a fucking rose, man. So
there it is. Exactly.
Yeah. So we've been talking for an hour. I still have like a long list of notes, so we might have to do a double.
A triple.
Yeah.
Because I left my notebook downstairs, but you know, I could make some notes.
Yeah, those are a few of our thoughts about women and emotional states and seeing beauty in the world. But we've got a lot more to talk about. I've got a ton of notes to discuss with Aaron here, so we'll get into that in a future episode.
Yeah, there's an endless knocking at the door.
All right, time to go.
Cool. Okay. Cool, man. Thanks for checking out another episode. Here we are. We made it to the top of the unearthed pyramid of the Guachimontones. So from here, we have the view of the principal pyramid, right there, the round pyramids of close to Guadalajara. We can see Teochitlan, which is a town at the bottom of the hill here. And if you want to get show notes, jump on www.theparadiseparadox.com. I'm not going to quote which number this episode is because I forgot. If you're interested in more in the Guachimontones or Teochitlan, there is an episode maybe about 50 ago of the Paradise Paradox here where Kurt, myself, Luke from We Are Change, and a friend, Rodolfo, actually come out here and visit the Guachimontones. So check that out. It's only short, but you get our first impression. Check the links below to see that. Thanks again for checking us out. Follow us, subscribe, like, you know what to do, and stay tuned for the next episode of Enlightenment. Peace, love, and be well.